Okay. Good afternoon, and today we shall be discussing on Aga Shahid Ali's poem, Farewell. Farewell is from his collection, very popular collection, and one of the very famous collections of Aga Shahid Ali that was published in 1997, and name of the collection is The Country Without a Post Office. The Country Without a Post Office is his third book. And once again, this collection was a kind of a sensational, as it deals primarily with a homeland that you generally find in the case of Aga Shahid Ali is basically imaginary in condition. So Aga Shahid Ali's homeland, a self-exiled man, a self-exiled poet. The concept of a home that we find in his poem, it's all about a sort of an imaginary homeland in one hand, and a sense of dislocation that the persona suffers all the time in his poems, and particularly in this collection, The Country Without a Post Office. And there is a separate poem with this particular title. So most of the poems are focused on Kashmir, issues of Kashmir, and the way people stay there, and the chronic change that was felt by the speaker, and that took place very soon, that early moments of peaceful cohabitation of different religious sects, you know, believers, practitioners, gradually that peaceful cohabitation, it was no longer available. So that pain, that sense of suffering, sense of loss is very much there in almost all the poems of The Country Without a Post Office. And the poem that is the point of our discussion today, Farewell, is also in a very similar fashion a poem of loss, obviously, which is very common in Aga Shahid Ali. Farewell is not only saying goodbye to a place, a land of love, a land of affection, a land of so many thoughts, imaginations, emotions. Probably it is very symbolic. Probably the speaker in the poem knows it well, that the chronic degradation that the place is now experiencing, it's never ever possible to go back to that very previous condition. So it is a farewell to that very happy state. It is a farewell to that very condition that once upon a time the speaker enjoyed, but he knows it well, to go back to that very past is no way possible. So Farewell is a poem of grief, a poem of intuition, a journey that the speaker would like to go through to search for those eternal values, eternal memories, eternal friendships that once upon a time it was so beautifully practiced, but now somehow it's no longer available. It's not there. It was Aga Shahid Ali's own opinion that the poem should be read as a narrator who is addressing a Kashmiri Pandit. Now, in Kashmir, we know that the way Muslims are there for centuries or more than centuries. So are the Kashmiri Pandits. Both these two kind of people, they are living together peacefully for long. But the speaker somehow now can feel it well that those cohabitation, Kashmiri Pandits and the Muslims of that location, that old friendship, that kind of living together peacefully, those old moments, that is rapidly getting changed. And that change, he could feel well. Now, from that very perspective, the narrator is addressing the fellow Kashmiri Pandit, who is a friend. And from that very approach, the poem should be read. So we are going to read the poem from that very angle. Now comes the opening lines. At a certain point, I lost track of you. Now look, the very opening line of the poem, Farewell, it reminds how friendships, how cohabitation, how age-long mutual understanding, ultimately, these words do not work. Rather, due to the political, social, and the cultural conditions, one cannot be of the very same track that he used to be earlier. So naturally, the very opening line is very significant, that the speaker is saying here that at a certain point, I lost track of you. The track is no longer available. The track is not traceable. Quite similar way, if you, we would like to connect the condition that is available here, as Aga Shahid Ali would like to point out, the very same sort of fate were there when West Bengal experienced, or some of the people of West Bengal experienced, who came leaving their motherland that fell in Bangladesh. Now, the kind of Muslim families in Bangladesh, as they used to live together very peacefully with all those Hindus over there, but due to the political conditions, since Bangladesh was earlier a part of Pakistan, and it was then known as East Pakistan, and then after much struggle, in 1971, now Bangladesh could have its own identity as a separate country, and no longer it was a part of East Pakistan or Pakistan. Now, we know that it was that very high time. People could, gradually they could feel that it is of no use to stay there. Those old friendships, the homes, the lands, they had to live over there, and they had to cross the border and to settle here without any place to stay, without any source of income, without any stable position to stay in Bengal, in India at that very moment. Now, this is how the thing happened. Old friendships in Bangladesh didn't work. But we know history says that so many benevolent Muslim families were there who also gave such kind of assurance that there will be no trouble for the Hindu families over there. But still, they decided not to stay there, rather to cross the border and to settle down here. Now, these are some of the very basic historical events that people of Bengal and in Bangladesh, they have witnessed together. Now, when we come to the point of Farewell by Aga Shahid Ali, this lost track is something. What is that, you know, what is lost over there? That faith, mutual understanding, friendship, peacefulness that was there so long, suddenly the speaker is not able to track it down. Almost like an aeroplane, when from the control room of the airport, they cannot track the exact position of the flight. So the flight is missing. Somehow that mutual love is missing. That affection is missing. That friendship is no longer available there. Rather, what is happening right now, only things of the very opposites, enmity, isolation, desolation, mistrust, such kind of things are coming up gradually now. They make a desolation and call it peace. Now the speaker is very sorry for the kind of social and the cultural setup that they often place in front of the inhabitants of that locality, that now their land is very peaceful. But in the name of offering peace, the speaker is saying, actually what is placed in front of them, this one is desolation, isolation, and destruction. So offering destruction first, they promote that what are they offering to the people of the Kashmir? This one is peace. You cannot enjoy peace when there is desolation. You cannot enjoy peace when there is destruction and devastation everywhere. Because at that very moment, what disturbs you is the worry, the panic, the pain, and the suffering. So this is how the old order got changed. This poem speaks of that change in the society, change in the belief system, change in that tradition that they had so long of that particular area. When you left, even the stones were buried, the defenseless would have no weapons. Now, some extra authorial power is so supreme that it left the rest of the people weaponless. The rest of the people could do nothing, and there was no option left for them. They are the mute spectators. They are the mute listeners, because some more powerful factors were there to maintain, to control their peace, their everyday life, all sort of transactions. It was controlled. And peace actually remained in the as a very fictitious kind of an object, but the real peace was nowhere available. When the ibex rubs itself against the rocks, ibex is a kind of an animal basically found in European countries, almost like a deer or a goat having some huge horns. So it has fleece also on the body. When the ibex rubs itself against the rocks, who collects its fallen fleece from the slopes. O weaver whose seams perfectly vanished. Now seam, the word seam is actually joining together two ends. Now this particular word seam is significant, important in the context that now gradually these two kind of people who used to live together peacefully as two brothers, now there is a bifurcation. Now government, authority and others are trying to make a kind of a weaving of that fracture between the two. And it may seem to us apparently that it is perfectly that particular place of joining together is perfectly vanished, but actually it is not so. Who weighs the hairs on the jeweler's balance? They make a desolation and call it peace. Who is the guardian tonight of the gates of paradise? Now Kashmir, which was actually once upon a time a gate of paradise, is now without any guardian. Now there is no one to look after it. Kashmir is really, those who have visited the place, due to the beauty and the natural perfection, the glamour, the charm of nature is so measureless, it should be properly called a paradise on earth. But that paradise is no longer a paradise. Somehow it is a pandemonium, it is a chaos, it is a place of desolation, it is a place of death. So in the name of desolation, this particular phrase, line, here is once again repeated by the speaker. In the name of desolation, they offer that, okay, the place is peaceful, but it is not exactly. What apparently it is seen, exactly the real condition is something else. So here the speaker is continuously placing two opposites, the apparent and the real. The real is something else, and apparently it is projected as something else. And apparently everyone is projected that the land is very peaceful, it is actually a place of death and destruction. So history disturbs the speaker continuously. This chronic degradation disturbs, puts question in the mind of the speaker in the poem. My memory is again in the way of your history. So this place that we call paradise on earth, what is over there now? Army convoys all night like desert caravan. As are the caravans on desert that pass on that over the sands, over the dunes, it go on almost like the same in this paradise. What is more to be seen are the convoys of the army. And that's true. In the smoking oil of dimmed headlights, time dissolve all winter, its crust fennel, we can't ask them, are you done with the world? So now, all the liberty, all the opportunity of the people over there, that the people of the place enjoyed earlier, now they can't enjoy. There is always a sense of suspicion, a sense of doubt. No one can ask to the other what is really happening, because no one has the exact information. Everything is so hushed up. Everything is suppressed powerfully, forcefully. Since everything is suppressed in that very way, so time dissolves. Nothing is clear to anyone. No one has exact information. Everything is shrouded in a mystery. In the lake, the arms of temple and mosque are locked in each other's reflection. One of the beautiful lines in the poem, Farewell. Now the speaker's memory reminds him that he used to see in the water of the lakes the reflections of the temple and the reflections of the mosque. And how was the reflection? That they lock in each other's reflection. The arms of the temple and the arms of the mosque, almost like they are hugging each other. That friendship that they enjoyed earlier, it is on the reflection. The reality, they are far, far away. But still, the reflection that the speaker can perceive, he can reflect upon that really once upon a time, this kind of mutual respect, mutual love to each other that was very much there in the land of paradise. Now there is only suspicion. It is merely a reflection. But the reality is different. Have you soaked saffron to pour on them when they are found like this centuries later in the country? I have stitched to your shadow. Is the speaker trying to stitch on, trying to coalesce, trying to attach the huge gap that has already been made by the people over there? Now, old emotions are only shadows. Old reflections are only shadows. Can the speaker be of that capacity to stitch together the gap that has been made in course of time? It is very impossible. The speaker himself knows it well. But still, the pang, the sorrow in which he is suffering from, that is very much there in him. In this country, we step out with doors in our arms. Children run out with windows in their arms. You drag it behind you in lit corridors. If the switch is pulled, you will be torn from everything. Now the memory of the children, memory of the taking arms by one, by the other, the kind of friendship, those are merely imagination. But those were really in practice for a long time. Now those old practices, old culture, it is utopian. It is something that can only be imagined in the brain. Now everything is torn apart. Everything is far, far away. At a certain point, I lost track of you, my dear friend. If that tentative friend is a Kashmiri Pandit, the speaker is very sorry to say, but still he has no option. What he is trying to say, the reality, and that's why he repeats again, at a certain point, I lost track of you. You needed me when you were in crisis, my dear friend. You needed me badly, but I couldn't be there at your help. You needed me. You needed to perfect me. In your absence, you polished me into the enemy. Your history gets in the way of my memory. I am everything you lost. You cannot forgive me. I am everything you lost. You perfect enemy. Your perfect enemy. Your memory gets in the way of my memory. This beautiful section, stanza, talks about that huge gap which has already been made by the two different religions over there. People of two different practitioners. Now, when they used to be there together mutually, now when one needed the other, they could not appear in time. Naturally, it was a sort of unhappiness, a sort of misunderstanding one by the other, that the friendship is no longer there, only the sense of enmity. But history is very much there in the memory of the speaker, and he knows it well. I am everything you lost. You can't forgive me. The speaker knows it well that he cannot be forgiven, or the people of one sect by the other cannot be forgiven anymore. But what is the result? What is the outcome? The result is enmity, enemy. Your memory gets in the way of my memory. They are friends, even together probably, but it is not in reality, it is only in the memory. I am being rowed through paradise in a river of hell. The Dal Lake probably is very dull now. Is it the river of hell from where there is no conditions of rejuvenation possible? That re-enkindling the spirit is no longer possible? Revival of friendship is no longer possible? Rather, what is available now? Only the exquisite ghost. It is night. The paddle is a heart. It breaks the porcelain waves. It is still night. The paddle is a lotus. I am rowed as it withers toward the breeze, which is soft as if it had pity on me. Now, when the speaker paddles in the water, when the speaker passes time on the water, he doesn't find his heart enlivened. It withers. The breeze is still soft, no doubt, but it seems to him that the gentle breeze is actually showing pity on him. If only somehow you could have been mine, what wouldn't have happened in the world? This very significant question. Now, one is of his own. The other is similarly of his own. If only somehow you could have been mine. Now, this possibility is only a possibility. The speaker knows it well that the other, the friend, he can never be of his own. But it is only a big if. If it could be something like that, then probably it would have been totally different. But it is only a possibility. An imagination. And for which there is no solution at that very moment. Only a deep sense of regret that they need to carry with them all the time. And out of this deep sense of regret, the speaker says, I am everything you lost. You won't forgive me. My memory keeps getting in the way of your history. There is nothing to forgive. You can't forgive me. I hide my pain even from myself. I revealed my pain only to myself. There is everything to forgive. You can't forgive me. If only somehow you could have been mine, what would not have been possible in the world? With this big question, the poem comes to an end, and the poem talks a lot about that question for which there is no answer. Even the person, the speaker who is putting the question on, he knows it well, for which the person to whom the question is addressed, there is no definite answer. Because it is now an imaginary concept. And for that imaginary homeland, for that imaginary moments of mutual understanding, that total setup is lost, and it is lost forever. It is only in the memory that they should carry. In reality, present generation, future generation, of course we cannot say so early, but it is something for which the final solution to reach to that very past, to that very glorious past, probably it is no longer possible. With this deep sense of sorrow, with this deep sense of loneliness, it is a kind of a burden, cultural burden, a social burden. The speaker is not responsible, but somehow the total setup, the condition is made in such a way for which there is no outcome and there is no possibility even. So why not to have a farewell? The title Farewell connects us that the speaker would like to farewell his place of paradise, because paradise is no longer a paradise. The speaker knows it well. So the speaker is actually giving farewell to it, a valedictory message to the land, homeland. The homeland is now only in the memory of the speaker. It is that valedictory arguments that operate in his mind all the time. It is a kind of a nice monologue that we can say. A monologue that puts questions the speaker all the time, that he feels all the time within, but the speaker is helpless. He is only a mute spectator of this particular event. Thank you so much. We are coming to an end to this discussion, and thank you for listening this one.